Cause you've never lost a battle. No, you've never lost a battle. And I know you never will. Everything's possible.
Well, hey, First Assembly, this is the beginning of what we refer to as Passion Week. In fact, this Sunday is Palm Sunday, and we celebrate that with you. What an incredible time as we go through the Scripture and the Gospel of Jesus coming into Jerusalem. For those of us who have been to Jerusalem, there's a fondness as we read through the Scripture now, because the things we're seeing in the pages of God's Word, there are many of those places we have actually walked in. The scenery is vivid. It's real. I love this time of the year. In fact, I love Good Friday. You've heard me say that Good Friday is my favorite service in the year. And as I think about it, man, there was such a disappointment that began to settle in a few hours ago as I realized that that was not a reality for us locally. And then I had an idea. Dear friend of ours, Pastor Rod Loy, pastors First Assembly, North Little Rock, a great church, and they've been great friends to your pastors and to this church. They invited us as a church to join with them for the Good Friday service, which we wholeheartedly agreed and celebrated and cannot wait to join with them. So this coming Friday, we are having our Good Friday service. It will be a connection with First Assembly North Little Rock at 7 p.m. So we're going to have social media watch parties. We're going to have links to our online service where you can do and be a part of that. We're going to take communion together. We're going to remember the cross. We're going to celebrate what Jesus did as a victory. And knowing that Good Friday is not the end, we're moving towards Sunday and Easter celebration. And so, man, join our family. We're going to engage in the service. We're going to participate. We're going to take communion again. So that's happening at 7 p.m. this Friday, Good Friday. Can't wait to see you online. God bless you, and we love you.
Embrace, light of the world forever. In the New Testament, there was no church that was more generous than the Macedonian church. In 2 Corinthians 8, 1-5, Paul tells us how their joy overflowed in rich generosity. The encouraging thing for us about this joy was the circumstances it came from. Paul explains that they were in the midst of severe trials and extreme poverty, and it was in these times that God gave them this overflowing joy that resulted in generosity. Trials and suffering couldn't shake these believers because they didn't care about stuff. Their secret was not what belonged to them, but who they belonged to. And every one of us will also face trials and sufferings at some point in our lives. And just like the Macedonians, we must decide who or what we will trust in when they do arise. So let's look at three truths that the Macedonian believers teach us that will help us obtain the same joy and generosity they had in their extreme poverty. First, nothing can shake the joy of the generous. Paul's description of the Macedonian state of affairs should not be taken lightly. Severe tests of affliction and extreme poverty. These circumstances were more than minor setbacks, yet God gave them the joy to not only make it through, but to give generously in the process. Secondly, generosity flows from a heart of self-sacrifice, not self-preservation. The motivation of giving is not to give in order to get. Instead, just like the Macedonians, it begins with our surrender to God and flows from His joy as we trust in Him. And finally, biblical giving comes from grace, not the law. Tithe, or 10%, is the biblical starting point for giving. Jesus validated this in Matthew 23, but as the Macedonians showed us, their giving was a direct result of the joy they found in God's grace, not from an obligation to give. These verses model for us the response God is looking for when we look at our financial situation. Paul tells us that the Macedonians gave themselves first to the Lord, and in the same way we should approach our finances by first affirming or reaffirming our commitment to trust God's promises. And secondly, we are told the Macedonians gave. Their generosity was the proof of where their joy really came from. And in the same way, our giving echoes what our hearts are trusting in.
Hello, Garden City First family. I'm here to talk to you about giving. Thank you for continuing to be generous with your tithes and offerings. Hebrews 12:28 says, "Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful and so worship our God." When we give our tithes and offerings, we are worshiping our King. There's a couple of ways that you can give. The first is text to give, 404-480-8182. And the subdomain is First Assembly GC. The second way that you can give is by going online to firstassemblygc.genrush.org. The third way is by mailing your tithes and offerings to P.O. Box 417, Garden City, Kansas, 67846. And the fourth way is by dropping by our office Monday through Thursday from 11 to 3. If you need help setting up your online giving, we would love to help you. Please call our office at 620-276-3371. Your faithfulness in giving during this time allows us to keep ministering. So thank you for being faithful and consistent.
Well, hey, First Assembly, my goodness, what a great day it has been. And this is Palm Sunday, and we celebrate that with you, hence the nice green. So if you're watching this at a later date, man, we're celebrating what Jesus has done, and we celebrate that whether it's in a local building or in our homes. And so that's just a constant reminder for you and I that Jesus is still Lord and He's still on His throne. Several weeks ago, we had time to just speak into you as a church, and I want to do that again. And one of the things we ask that you would help do is we're praying that God would help you maintain your faith. In fact, Jesus prayed that over the disciples in the early Gospels and saying, hey, I want you to maintain your walk with Christ. And so I believe that as we come out of this season as a church and as the capital church, I believe God's going to advance us in our faith, in our moments of prayer and our Bible reading. I believe there will be disciplines established in this season that will catapult us into what God has us for, planned for us in the future. And then I want you to stay connected. I know that looks different than maybe years gone by and even weeks gone by, but over the last several weeks, you should have been connected with someone from our local church, either through a phone call or a message or an email. We believe that God is going to help us come out of this season so much stronger than we went into it. And then also, I want to say thank you. Thank you for your giving. Thank you for your faithfulness that you have demonstrated during this time There's multiple ways now still that you're able to give. The two that we would recommend would be online giving and then giving through the mail, either sending that through your local postal service. And that's just a simple P.O. Box 417, Garden City, Kansas, 67846. And I just say thank you. We're still doing ministry. We pivoted and we're adjusting some of the things that we had planned. This weekend, we should have had missions emphasis with our missions partner that we're going to reach in Cuba and what we're doing in Cuba Bible College. That's kind of pivoting a little bit and doing some things different. We're rescheduling that for a later date, but we're still committed to our missionaries. We're still giving. And I just want to say thank you. Thank you for your faithfulness to this house. We're believing God's continuing to see us advance the gospel, not just here, but around the world as we are walking through this together. And then lastly, I just want us to take a moment and pray. I want us to pray over our nation. I know we've been praying globally for God to do great things in this season, but I want us to pray for our nation, and I want us to pray as well locally. And so that's where I want us to direct our season in this moment. And as we do that, I want you to remember a couple of things. One, that God sees what we're going through. This has not caught Him by surprise, even though it may have surprised us to some level, to the magnitude it is. But God sees right where we are. But also, know that God cares for us today. I love that reality, that not only does He see, but He cares. And in that moment, this is where we connect it. We're under the understanding, we have this knowledge that God answers prayer. And there's something powerful. We know the scriptures and we can quote them probably, but we are getting to live out the book of Acts in this day. And so thank you for doing that. I want us to pray collectively. And as we do that, here's the prayer that I have for us. And that is to remember that goodness of God is on display. And so I want us to pray together. I want us to pray for our local schools, that God would surround them. I want us to pray for the administrator and faculty and staff and support staff. I want us to pray for our first responders, those that are caring in our local city and county. I want us to also pray for our hospitals, our nurses, our staff, the administrators there. And then I want us to pray for the caregivers, those who are caring for maybe elderly, those in the care centers here in our local community. As you and I go through our normal activity and business, not only are they caring for their own personal needs, but they also care for those in our home. I have a son, Nathaniel. Many of you know him very well. Nathaniel is not fully understanding this quarantine because of some of his special needs. He's struggling with the process of not being able to get out and about and see people, and he is very social. I think of my friend Johnny, who I've reached out to and called and talked to him, and his number one question is, why? Why is this going on? And I don't have an answer to give to Johnny. I just say, buddy, it's what's best. But I want us to pray for our caregivers. So would you join me? Let's take a moment. Lord, we thank you that in all the things that are changing, our culture shifted, our routines have changed. I'm so thankful that God, you do not change. And thank you, Jesus, that you're the same. And in this moment, we rely in a different level upon you. Not that we've changed, but Lord, we need more grace and more peace. And we have a deeper understanding of what it means to be content in all seasons. God, I pray over our local school districts. I pray, God, that you would surround them with the presence of God, that you would give them peace that goes beyond what they've experienced in days past. I pray for creativity as they are finding ways to connect with students. And God, I pray for blessings upon them. I pray for the support staff as they are caring, and many of them are coming in during the morning hours and preparing meals for students and serving them. God, I pray for our community college, that you would give them wisdom and grace and divine favor. God, I ask that you would be with responders, our first responders, both in our city and in our county. God, I pray as they have already put plans in place for emergency response and how to care for situations that as, Lord, they look to arise in the coming weeks, God, I pray blessings over them. I pray that when they're on call, that there would be a peace that surrounds them. I pray when they go home with their family, there's a healthy disconnect from the role that they serve in. God, I pray for those that serve our county and city and our health department, our hospitals, our nurses. God, I pray for our doctors that they are surrounded with the presence of God that gives them a peace and an assurance. God, I pray that there would be a sense of calm. Lord, I pray over those that are in our community that serve special needs like Mosaic and others. God, I pray that there would be a comfort that settles over them. I pray for wisdom as they attempt to communicate the realities of our changing culture. I pray that there would be a calm that settles over them. Spirit of the living God, make yourself known to them. We thank you, Lord, for all these things. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for joining us, and we're going to jump right into God's Word. And as you do that, go with us to, we're going to go to John chapter 11. But before you do, I'm telling you, I'm loving the book of Hebrews more and more. And that has just been where we've been parking the last several weeks. And we'll get to John 11 or John 14 in a moment, and then also to John 11. But let me just encourage you this morning. I don't know where you came from. I don't know the background of what has brought you to this service today. I know for our local church family, we're walking through some very unusual moments. But I do know this. In the midst of all of it, God's Word wants to speak to us. So if you've come today and you're watching this service and your life is broken, maybe you are overwhelmed. Maybe you're depressed or dejected or disheartened. Maybe you believe that God's giving up on you, or maybe you just think that this is so discouraging. I'm losing hope. I'm overwhelmed. There's uncertainty all around me. I want you to understand that I believe God's given us a word for us as a church family today. And if you're not a part of First Assembly, we just welcome you in. Thank you for joining us. And we're believing that God's going to speak to our heart and to our life today. As we do that, let me remind you of just four things. These are truths that I believe God wants to keep speaking to us. We're speaking on these on our Wednesday night moments that we're joining together. And these are things that do not change. And so I want you to remember that God sees what we're going through. God also cares about where you're at. Not only that, but He has the power and the authority to answer prayer. And so that's why we pray as a church. And I love this, that we know that God acts out of His goodness towards us. I love Corinthians, and this is where I want us today to bring our mind into the authority that God's called us to walk in, and that is simply this. Blessed is the Lord God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, the God of all encouragement, who encourages us in all our afflictions so that we may be able to encourage those who are in any affliction with the encouragement with which comes from ourselves. We are encouraged by God. And then our theme for this series, I want you to not only be encouraged, but I want you to remember the truths of God's Word. Hebrews tells us this, I will never, under any circumstances, desert you, nor give you up, nor leave you without support, nor will I in any degree leave you helpless, nor will I forsake you or let you down or relax my hold on you. Surely not. So take comfort. Be encouraged and confidently say, the Lord is my helper in time of need. I will not be afraid. So we can take confidence. We can take hope. We can take encouragement in this moment. I love it because the promises of God is, he says that he's going to help us in this moment. Well, there's a story in the New Testament. It's one that really is quite surprising. It comes from John chapter 11, and in this moment, I won't read it verbatim, but I want you to just go there. It's a story of Lazarus, Mary, and Martha. Jesus is a dear friend. In fact, we see through Jesus' ministry, 3.5 years, that he stays with Mary and Martha on multiple occasions. It's just a little village outside of Jerusalem, and Bethany is this place that Jesus can kind of get away. And in this moment, I want you to see a bigger picture, a bigger message, because what we are walking through as a nation and as a globe has a tendency to affect us more than just the physical side, but also the mental side. In this moment, there's a lot of news that's inundating us. There's a lot of perspective that's constantly bombarding us. And you get this perspective, you change the channel, you get this perspective, you have that show end, and you have this perspective, and you have this expert and that expert. And by the time you're done, I don't know if you feel like me, but there are moments that I think I'm a sponge and I have absorbed and taken everything I can. I can't take anymore. And that's kind of what we see here. In this moment of story of in the Gospel of John, there is a moment that Lazarus is sick. We know the end result is not good. But in fact, I want us to take something far beyond that. I want us to see that God does something that you and I think is impossible, and it becomes a normal reality for the people in the story. Mary and Martha and Lazarus, their story is maybe similar to what you think today. You have had dreams. You've had some desires. You've had anticipation of God doing certain things, and it has not happened yet. In fact, all the coronavirus and all the things that are happening has only caused you to doubt the reality that is going to happen. When you look at this story, I want you to understand the characters here, the sisters, Mary and Martha, Lazarus, the disciples. Jesus responds, but he doesn't respond in the way you and I think. And when you read the story, John 11, and you can go through it, starting at verse 1, you can just begin to see something that you and I deal with as well today. And that is, one, we really just don't understand how God works. We're saying, God, this is how we're praying. We believe you're going to answer. We expect you to show up in this situation. And it seems like everything's going wrong. And we're saying, God, I don't understand. I prayed. I've sought you. I've asked you to help my marriage. And then you quarantine me with my spouse. Help me, Lord. God, I ask you to help me with my children. I prayed that you would save them. God, and yet they're going 100 miles the other direction. I don't know where you're at this morning with this situation that you've been praying over, but what I have had to realize again and again personally is that I don't always understand what God's doing. My thinking is different than his. But I do know this, that when these moments happen, John 11, 6, I love this because it says, when they came and said, hey, Lord, Lazarus is sick. It says, Jesus stayed there 2 more days. Well, I felt like that too. I felt like, God, I prayed, I asked for an answer, and you missed a great opportunity to show up. You've delayed answering my request. God, I don't know where you're at or what you're doing. But what I've come to realize again and again is Jesus has a different perspective than I do. In fact, he says this in John 11:11. It says, after this, he said to them, tell them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I'm going there to wake him up. His disciples replied, Lord, if he sleeps, he'll get better. Come on, a nap's always going to make you better, right? I mean, that's what the disciples are like, oh, he's going to wake up and feel better. And Jesus said, no, I've been speaking of death, but his disciples thought of natural sleep. Even his disciples who had been with him for 3.5 years, they didn't understand. And here's what you and I have to remember, even in these moments, God is a redeemer. I don't know what he's doing behind the scenes. I know there are moments that we feel, maybe God, we're going to see us through this. And then you have the wave of emotion and you're like, God, are we going to make it? But I've come to tell you that God is a redeemer. And what the enemy meant for evil, God redeems for good. The life of Joseph proves it. The life of Esther proves it. The life of Ruth proves it. The life of the disciples prove it. And the life of Nathan has declared it again and again. What the enemy meant for evil, God redeems and makes for good. I don't understand how he works, but I've learned to trust him in his work. Not only that, but listen, we also get caught up in doubt. Boy, have you found yourself finding those moments to be true lately? Doubt overtakes us. We begin to worry about what's going to happen next. The story of Lazarus continues, and we see it in what we know is Thomas. It says, then Thomas said to the rest of the disciples, let us go so that we may die also with him. Now, I don't know what you think about this, but when I read this text and verse 16, I immediately in this moment have the picture of Eeyore, Winnie the Pooh, and this moment where you're just like, let us go and die also. I mean, I think of doom, gloom, and despair. This is not what the disciples signed up for. They're believing that God's going to do something incredible, that he's going to set up a kingdom, he's going to destroy the Roman rule. And in this moment, we begin to get caught up in doubt. Can I just encourage you, as we did last week, man, when you sense the doubt and when you sense the fear and the anxiety, dive into the Word of God. Begin to declare the truths of God's Word. Begin to declare that He is good and He does good. Declare God's promises upon your life. Speak life, not death. Some of you have become so engaged with the news and social media, it has literally become your Bible. What I've come to declare over us as a church is don't waste this moment. Don't waste discovering God's promises for you in this season. Yes, there is sorrow. Yes, there is sadness. But God's faithfulness is as true today as it was on January 1st, 2020. God's truths and faithfulness are as true today as they were the day you first believed. God has not changed. He has not left the kingdom of heaven. He has not dethroned himself. He is still faithful. He is still God, and he will see us through this. Amen. Speak life. But listen, it's hard to believe when there's death and doubt all around. And what begins to happen in those moments is suddenly you begin to give up on God. And I want to speak over those of you today. It's been a few weeks now since we maybe gathered together. And you may say, Pastor Nathan, I just don't know. I don't know what God's doing. I feel isolated. I feel abandoned. I feel disconnected. I'm not hearing God. And I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you this morning. Listen, you must have an experience with God personally. He wants that. That's why he came. That's why he came as a babe in a manger. That's why he's lived his life the way he did. That's why he modeled for the early church what we were to look like. It wasn't so it was through a one individual or several individuals. God desires a personal relationship with you. And so what I want us to walk into this morning is, looking at what Martha says in this moment, John 11:20, it says, "And when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home." She stayed at home. She stayed in the house. Listen, in this season, it's revealed some realities that were already in existence, but it's revealed them in a larger scale. In this moment, your marriage, it's revealed that there's a separation or a disconnect. Your happiness, it's revealed that it was built upon what you had and what you could do, and your shopping ability and your spending ability. Your money, it's revealed that, man, my finances were my hope. For those of you that have become isolated, it's become easier to become entangled with sin in your individual lives. And I've come to tell you that Jesus wants you to awaken this afternoon or morning or whenever you're watching. Listen, I just want to ask you a simple question. What is it in your life that's dead or dying? Maybe it's a dream that this season has revealed something. You're saying, man, I don't know what the future looks like. We've all had to adjust some hopes. Over the last couple of days, I had some opportunities that we had planned months ago together with some friends this past week. And we were going to go together and we were getting away and planning a golf trip and just spending some time together as three friends. And we canceled that. And can I just tell you that as I did not take it off my calendar until just a few days ago. And when I did, man, I grieved. I grieved. And then the perspective sets in, of course, but there's disappointment. But maybe that's so small compared to things in your life. Is there some things that God is wanting you to address? Maybe you need to conquer some things in your life that you've allowed to conquer you. Maybe it seems like it's as significant as Mary and Martha's thing that they're battling. When I look at it, I love this because if there is something that's in your life and it's dying, a dream, your relationship with Christ, your marriage, your relationship with your children, maybe the stress of this has created such chaos and tension. John 11:25-26, it says this, and Jesus said, "I am the resurrection." We'll celebrate that next Sunday. "I'm the resurrection and life. He who believes on me will live, even though he dies. Whoever lives and believes, he will never die." Do you believe this? Do you believe this? So I want to give you a couple simple statements as we close. I need you today to settle who Jesus is. Settle in your heart who he is. I believe in this moment that God has helped us to dig deeper, to dive in a greater depth of understanding. What you see in John 11, Martha says this, "I believe you are the Christ." I believe, not they believe, I believe. What are you believing in and who are you believing? Christos, the Christ, the anointed one, the one who has power over all situations. Listen, I want us as a church to understand that God is still victorious. God is still on his throne. Settle it in your heart. God is still faithful. She had settled this. Even though she wanted a different outcome, she settled this. John 11 tells us again, he says, "And Lord," Martha said, "if you had been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask." Would you settle in your heart who Jesus is? A couple of days ago, I went back into an old book that I'd got from years ago, a book titled The Fourth Man. Oral Roberts, founder of ORU, Oral Roberts University, when he would hold tent revivals, it was one of his famous sermons. And I love it because as you dive into it, man, it's good stuff. And he goes through the whole entire scripture and every book in the New Testament and Old Testament. He begins to give an image of who Christ is. And he goes through it. And then he goes to the moments in the New Testament and begins to unpack those. And he begins to just see all these things of who Jesus was. And I love it because when I see that, man, something builds up within inside of me. I want you to today begin to settle who Jesus is. I also want you just simply to do this. Stop analyzing everything. Listen, you can analyze this until you are through and through exhausted, tired. You say, well, Pastor, listen, I'm just trying to process it. I'm trying to understand where it's at. Listen, you cannot have faith if you're going to listen with your mind and your feelings. Because your feelings will lie to you, and your mind simply cannot understand the things that God is doing. Proverbs says that His ways are beyond our ways. I love what we wrap up the story of John 11. It says this, and Jesus was deeply moved. He came to the tomb and to the cave where the stone was laid at the entrance, and He said, "Take away the stone." "But Lord," Martha said, "the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, and he has been there for 4 days." Even Martha, in her faith, said, "God, I don't know how you're going to do this. It seems impossible. It seems really weird." Romans tells us this, and this is where we're wrapping up. "Without weakening of your faith, he faced the fact that his body was old and dead." It was gone. I love this because this is the story of Abraham. And it seemed like there was no way the promise of God was going to be fulfilled in his day. And in fact, he says, without weakening his faith, he faced the facts that his body was good and dead, and he was 100 years old, and Sarah's womb was also dead. But he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but he was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. I just want to wrap up this moment together and just tell you, listen, I don't know what promises God's been speaking to you before this moment, but those promises that he spoke to your heart, those dreams, those prayers that you've been praying, they did not become compartmentalized and put on a shelf somewhere because of Corona 19. The promises of God that you've been declaring over your family, you've been walking with individually, they have not changed because the economy of our society and the economy of the world has now in this moment in turmoil. The promises of God are still as true today as they were the day you first believed. Trust Him. Trust Him. Today we celebrate Palm Sunday. And I love the story of the triumphant entry. There were so many moments in the disciples' conversations with Jesus. They thought they understood the promises of God, and then they didn't. And the simple moment where he came in on it riding a colt that had never been broken, and the moment of triumph as people rejoiced and declared how great God was. Let me just tell you this. The key to unlocking your miracle is connected to the sound of your praise. So I don't know what you need to do today. I don't know if you need to turn off the TV, go out to the backyard, or find a place in your house, or take a walk. But somewhere you need to get alone with God, and like what we see in the triumphant entry, you need to declare the faithfulness of God. You need to declare the truths of God. You need to declare the promises of God. And I know this, God will reveal himself to you. Maybe today you say, "Pastor Nathan, I need the Lord to change my life. I've allowed the sin of my past and the reality of my present to make a separation between me and God. I want you to live again. I want you, like you see with the story of Lazarus." Listen, John 11, it concludes in verse 43 and 44. He does not stay in the grave. In fact, what we see at the end of that moment is he comes out. Jesus speaks with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." And the dead man, he was dead. He comes out, his hands, his feet wrapped in linen cloths and upon his face. And Jesus said, take away the grave clothes and let him go. God wants to do the very same thing for you this morning. What promises have you allowed to die in your heart? What truths have you allowed to become dormant in your life? I want us to take hold of them afresh and new. So would you bow your head with me this morning or afternoon or whenever you're watching this? Maybe God is asking you to come out of that grave. You say, well, Pastor, I can't do it. Well, just like we saw in the story of Lazarus, Jesus will remove the obstacle. He'll move the stone away. And you don't even have to clean yourself up. You just come out of the grave when he calls your name. And as he calls your name, I promise you this, he's going to begin to disconnect and untangle some of those things that have been holding you. It's time to move. It's time to unload what you've been carrying for too long. And if that's you today, I want to pray over you. In the comment section, or maybe if you're watching this on YouTube, there's a place for you to say, I'm receiving Christ as my Lord and Savior. And I want you to do that. I want to connect with you in just a moment. But I want to pray with you first. And you say, that's where I'm at, Pastor Nathan. I want to commit my life to Christ. I want to follow him. Simply, would you pray a prayer like this? It says, Jesus, I need you as my Savior. Lord, I declare that I need you to change my life. I can't do this on my own. Change me. Forgive me of my sin. Make me new. Change my heart and my mind in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you prayed that prayer today, I can promise you this. God wants to cause you to walk in freedom and liberty. For those of you today that need to hold on to promises of God, I want to pray that with you as well. And so, Lord, for every one of us today, as we walk in new understanding of your promises, oh, we knew that you were our provider. We understood that you were our strength. We know that you're our healer. But today we have better understanding. Today we have deeper knowledge of what that means. And so God, help us. Help us live again. Help us walk in freedom. Let us remember the best news we ever heard was that Jesus paid it all. And he provided hope and freedom for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. We love you.
Hey, 620 students, we are going on week 3 of church solely online, and I really just want to give you a high five. Yes, so good, so good. Okay, give me your attention for just a couple of minutes. My job here today is to help you apply what Pastor Nathan just spoke to your lives. As Pastor Nathan was speaking, I agreed with every single point, but it takes more than agreeing to walk away from a sermon and see life change. It takes action. There are 2 key thoughts that Pastor Nathan covered that I would like us to discuss and apply, and they are these. Stop analyzing everything and start living again. Pastor said it. You can't have faith if you're going to listen to your mind or your feelings. Your feelings will lie to you, and your mind is simply not in God's league. Right now, if you aren't reading your Bible every day, the only thing you're listening to is your own thoughts, the thoughts of your friends, your siblings, and hopefully your parents. I hope that you're respecting your parents, and I hope that your parents are encouraging you and that you really are hearing them. But in the event that you're not, or the truth is that even the other voices that you're listening to, your friends and your siblings, they're coming more often in your lives as your parents are busy providing for you. Your thoughts and your feelings and that of your friends, that's what's ruling your mind. And then add in addition to that, the things that you're watching and the games that you're playing. What kind of thoughts are flooding your mind? Think about it. What kind of thoughts are flooding your mind right now? Is your mind sarcastic? Is it a little bit attitude-y? Kind of grumpy? Maybe a little bit lazy? Your feelings will lie to you, and our minds are just not on God's level. But God is saying, talk to me, read my book, listen to my tunes, watch my shows, fill your day with my content, and let me change you. This, I believe, leads to Pastor's next point. Start living again. When you choose to fill your day with things of God, then your thoughts begin to change. God spoke to me that during this time, I needed to function from a place of abundance and not preservation. So every day, I'm waking up and I'm doing my devos, I'm doing my soaps. I listen to a sermon while I take a shower. I listen to only Christian music. I stop and pray when I need to if I'm feeling overwhelmed. And I read the Bible if I need to when I'm feeling overwhelmed or when I need a little bit of energy. I text my fierce, Jesus-loving friends when I need to, when I need some encouragement. Now, not every moment is hyper-spiritual with tears and altar calls all over my living room, right? Many moments I'm laughing with God and I'm smiling from really good Jesus memes. Y'all, the internet is on fire right now with funny stuff and more. But I'm not asking you to become Mother Teresa, okay? I'm not asking you to have really spiritual moments. I'm just asking you to talk to Jesus every day. And you know what? I bet Mother Teresa had fun with Jesus too. We have to start living again, 6-2-0 students. This is our lives for the coming weeks. We just have to accept that. Do you want to look back and say, man, I wasted that time? Or do you want to look back and be glad that you helped around the house, that you raised $1,000 for Speed the Light, that you built a really incredible relationship with your sibling, that you formed a new healthy habit, that you began praying and reading your Bible every single day? I don't say this insensitively, but COVID-19 is taking lives. I have many people on my prayer list right now who are wonderful friends in the medical field are taking care of because they're fighting for their life. And I believe in a God who still does miracles today. Amen? But COVID-19 is taking lives today, physically wounding people. But I also think that COVID-19 is emotionally and mentally wounding people. We cannot let COVID-19 dictate our lives, students. We cannot let COVID-19 take our lives. Those of us with breath must live because there are people in hospital beds who are hoping to get out and begging us to live. And I will say, I believe in a God who works miracles and who can provide a way for those people, those precious people laying in those hospital beds. And we're praying for them every day, and I hope that you will too. Students, like we talked about last Wednesday in Zoom Youth Group, Esther 4:14 says, if you persist in staying silent at a time like this, help and deliverance will arrive for the Jews from someplace else, but you and your family will be wiped out. Who knows? Maybe you were made queen for such a time as this. You are a 6-2-0 student for such a time as this. How can you live within your four walls? Grow closer to God and lead other people to that place as well. During this time, let's continue to merge 6-2-0. We love you. We miss you. If you need us, please reach out. Otherwise, we'll see you on Wednesday night at Zoom Youth Group.
Hey guys, it's Maddie Thompson, your local KFC Kids First coordinator. And I loved the message from today. It was really awesome. There were some words in it that I maybe hadn't heard before and thought you might not either. So we're going to kind of talk about that and break that down to help us understand today's sermon better. Usually when someone asks us how we're doing, we say basically the five same things. I'm good. I'm doing well. I'm doing all right. I'm okay. Or even if you've had like a really stinky day, I'm bad or I'm not okay. In today's lesson, we learned about the words depressed, dejected, disheartened, worried, restless, and anxious. These may have been words that you've heard some of the older people in your home saying, maybe your mom and dad or your brothers and sisters. So we're going to talk about what those words mean and maybe how they feel. When I hear the word depressed, it's kind of a really big word. And depressed is a big type of sadness that keeps you from being able to do your day-to-day things. Dejected. That's kind of a tough word, even kind of a tough word to say. Dejected rhymes with rejected, and they mean similar things. Dejected means that you feel kind of shut down. Maybe a lot of us are having that feeling right now. We feel dejected because we can't do the things we would normally do. Our school shut down, our playground shut down, we can't go to the store and see our friends. Disheartened. Let's talk about that for a second. We know that the beginning of the word is dis, and that is a prefix meaning not. So disheartened means that our hearts are feeling sad. So that's a really fancy, big way of saying we feel sad or disappointed. Worried. How many of you have heard the word worried before? I know I have. Worried feels like having the same negative thought over and over. So I worry about my dog, Gucci. He likes to dig holes. So if Gucci's outside and I'm downstairs, I get worried that Gucci might dig a hole. I think over and over, how long has Gucci been out there? Should I go and check on him? Has he dug in a hole? Has there been enough time for him to dig a hole? I should go check on Gucci. And so when we have thoughts like that over and over, that might be because you're worried. Restless, Pastor Nathan did a good job explaining. It means your mind won't stop. So how many of you have ever had like a super fun Valentine's Day party at school and you eat a lot of sugar and you just keep thinking about how much fun you've had over and over and over and over and over? And that is kind of a sense of restless. Sometimes we can have that same thing happen to us with negative feelings. Similar to worried, if I was worried or restless about Gucci, I would be afraid that he's not eating well enough or getting enough puppy playtime, or I'm worried that he's sad. And then anxious, that's a feeling some of us might be having but don't have the word for. The best way I've ever heard it explained is that you almost feel like you can't sit still. You may notice that you've been moving your hands more, or your mom and dad may be telling you, can you just calm down a little bit and take a seat? When we're anxious, we see that in ourselves because we're moving more, we're jittering more, and we're fidgeting a little bit more. It's kind of hard to learn all these new words, especially when they have kind of a sad or lame meaning. But they're really important because they help us understand the miraculous thing that God can do in our life. When we know the words to describe how we're feeling, we're able to communicate better, not only with our mom and dad, but also to God. When I feel anxious or worried, I say that to God. I say, God, I feel worried about COVID-19. God, I feel anxious about taking care of my daughter and making sure that she's safe. I feel disheartened that I can't go to school and do the things that I normally do. We see in Hebrews 13:5-6, from the Amplified Version, that God says, I will never desert you or leave you, and nor will I leave you helpless. I will not forsake you or let you down. Relax. Hold on. I am here for you. I love that verse from God because it speaks to me personally. It lets me know that he sees those negative emotions that I'm feeling, and he speaks that into me that I can have new life. When someone says I can have new life, it doesn't mean that I'm going to get born again as a tiny baby and my mom's going to raise me from being little tiny to a grown up again. It means that I'm going to have a new way of thinking. I'm going to trust in God to help relax my mind, to help provide fun, to help give me clarity and calm. This week, I pray that you will spend time communicating with your family about how you're feeling, good or bad, and also taking dedicated time to pray to God. Sometimes it can feel almost silly to pray by ourselves. I would encourage you to set a timer on Sunday night for 1 minute. And then on Monday night, I want you to set a timer for 1 minute and 30 seconds. And continue doing that to the end of the week, adding 30 seconds every time. During that minute, minute 30 seconds, 2 minutes, 2 minutes, 30 seconds, so on and so forth, I want you to talk to God about how you're feeling and what you've been experiencing. You will find that it's easy to talk to God, and that when you start to read your Bible afterwards, you hear God talking to you as well. I'm so grateful that you guys joined Pastor Nathan, Pastor McKenzie, and myself today with your families to hear what God's saying. I love you, and I'm giving you a big social distancing hug.
could find a way to just explain it. The way you turned me all around. And now my thankful heart just has to say it. I'm so glad your light came shining down. Jesus, you're the light of the world. I'll never walk in darkness again. Never walk in darkness again. Now I have the light of life. I'll never walk in darkness again. To stumble through my life without you, wandering lost out in the dark, trying to find a light that could outshine you, but there was nowhere I could start. Jesus, you're the
Thanks again for joining us for Church Online at Garden City First Assembly. It is always our hope to help you grow with your relationship with Christ and deepen your faith. All of our past and future online services will be available on our YouTube channel. The best way to know if there's new content is simply by subscribing. Again, thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next time.
Just one word, you calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Oh, just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see, my heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that a God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that a God can't do. In just one word, you heal what's broken inside. Let all agree, there's no power like the power.